Well, they've been the talking point of the season so far. Premiership favourites and yet winless after the first three rounds. Tonight, a chance to break the duck against the Northern Mystics. Good evening and welcome to Monday Night Netball. Right across the country, Kelly Underwood alongside former Australian captain Liz Ellis. And Liz, to add to the incentive tonight for the Queensland Firebirds, it's rivalry round, the culmination of rivalry round.
It certainly is. Now, rivalry round, of course, being the round where Australia plays against New Zealand effectively. The goals of every team are added up in every single game. They'll bring up a total. You'll see there, Australia are well ahead of New Zealand. My maths isn't quite good enough yet to figure out who's winning what. But Australia is winning. You'd almost suggest that this game won't decide rivalry round. I think Australia's got that well and truly in the bag after the Vixens win over the Mystics earlier tonight. What this game will decide, though, or go a long way towards deciding, is the makeup of the top four. Firebirds must win this game.
As we have a look at some of the crucial matchups in the starting seven, and Laura Geitz up against Catherine Latu, who for the Mystics has been in some sparkling form.
Yeah, Laura Geitz will really need to be strong on the body tonight. Steele and Tutaia will also be an important matchup. I'm loving what Claire McMenamin is doing at the moment. She's got a history in the last three games of shutting out players. She'll have her work cut out, though, tonight against Semipara George.
And we see the centre starting for the Mystics is Coffin. She's been battling a calf injury. She gets a start tonight, so that will push George into the wing attack position.
Sarah Wall and Larissa Wilcox will be a fiery battle. Nat Medhurst had a great first half last week against her old team, the Thunderbirds, but just faded away in the second half. She'll need a big game. This is going to be an explosive matchup, though. The two Jamaicans, Aiken and Byfield, battling out for pride as well as the 2 points for their team.
The all-Jamaican matchup. It will be an interesting subplot as we see the benches starting for each side. Well, we're lucky enough to have two of the top three most capped players in Australian netball history joining the broadcast tonight, along with Liz Ellis. Our courtside commentator is Vicky Wilson. And Vicky, well, you coached this side last year. What have you made to the, about their horror start, winless after the first three?
Well, it certainly isn't ideal, Kel, but an opportunity to put a win on the board tonight. They haven't ever lost to the Mystics, but the key battle will certainly be Tutaia and Amy Steele. Still yet to really hit some form in this competition, but Tutaia, she delivered for the Mystics in that first round game up against the Thunderbirds. So if she can do that tonight, it'll put them in a good place.
Thanks for that, Vicky. We'll cross to you courtside throughout the course of this match. It really is going to be a ripper, Liz, as we await for both sides to be introduced on centre court here in Brisbane. Head-to-head, round 13 last year, it was the Firebirds by two. And then round four in 2008, and it was the Firebirds by six. So the Mystics are yet to get them, but they've got a history of pretty close battles. And the Mystics looking for a slice of history themselves tonight, yet to win on Australian soil as we see them introduce Temapara George, the captain of this side, in wing attack.
The Mystics have recruited well, particularly this year with Maria Tutaia. Catherine Latu is also always going to give you a great target at the post, and she will always go to the post. She's a prolific shooter. Tutaia, though, out in front of her creates a dynamic, dangerous edge for those, for teams trying to defend against them. A lot of movement, quite clever with the ball, and she will shoot long bombs.
As we get ready for the crowd to get right behind, as Romelda Aiken is introduced on court. And there's Natalie Medhurst. She was the big story over summer, defected from the Adelaide Thunderbirds. And gee, she's had a long week, Natalie Medhurst, because she had a Fetiso shocker against her old side last week. Yeah. She'll be in for a big game.
Yeah, didn't have a great game in the second half. Faded out a little bit. Moni Gerard kept her in check in the last two quarters. You just get the feeling with Firebirds that they just need a win to remember how to do it. Once that happens, they'll start to become the unstoppable force that we all predicted before this season started. This is a huge game. Mystics have had two wins, the one loss to Magic this year, and there's no shame in losing to that New Zealand team. They will want to get on the ball tonight, though, and get 2 points up here. That will start to make them look pretty good for the top four. Firebirds need to win if they're going to seriously threaten for the semis.
So all is in readiness to wrap up round four. It is rivalry round. It will be decided here tonight. And it is the veteran mid-quarter and Jenny May Coffin that gets us underway. Northern Mystics looking to push into attack. And a good defensive start for the home side.
You see immediately the Australian one-on-one defence and the Australian style that the Firebirds are playing. What they do very well is get up in the face of the ball carrier, make it hard for her to see down court. Byfield gives away a lot of height.
Just inside.
To Romilda Aitken, but she has got the hops. She will get up there tonight and get a hand to plenty of ball.
Romilda Aitken, 196 centimetres, the tallest player in the league.
Contact keeper. So with the keeper. That's it.
Chance to sink the first one, and she does just that. So a good start for Romilda Aitken. 32 goals last week. Shooting at just 77% is her conversion rate heading into this round. So it's been down on last year. It was 83% last year. Natalie Medhurst from long range.
Great start for Medhurst. She's capable of dominating a game. What she hasn't shown this year is the capability to put four solid quarters together.
Contact.
That's got to be her challenge tonight.
This is Jolene Henry.
Causing wing attack.
New club this year.
Well done, guys. She'll have to keep her eye out for that long ball tonight. She, speaking to her before the game, she's so wary of not only Catherine Latu's hold, but just the movement. She's incredibly athletic.
Now they look to push it down the court through their captain, Nurse.
Holding wing attack.
Well, what was that called for, Liz? It went against the Firebirds.
Yeah, Sarah Wall called for holding. An unusual call when you're in attack.
Bandage wing attack contact.
Seen across the course of this weekend, a number of umpiring calls going against the run of play. They can really swing the momentum of a game.
Wing attack contact.
So the umpire's getting heavily involved here in the opening few minutes. A little stop start. Now Wall, the former Vixen, to Nurse. Long ball Medhurst out wide. She crosses the circle. Well, Byfield, she was up for it, all over it. She might go again. Aitken, the long reach.
Well, Byfield read that beautifully, a little too beautifully. Got there a little early and overran the intercept. Just watch it. She has the ability to just hang in the air. She's unbelievably athletic.
Perfect start here for the Firebirds. Mystics yet to score.
Ball then untouched. The ball wasn't touched or caught in the centre third off the centre pass.
This is Wilcox. Now to Henry.
Goal attack obstruction.
Jolene Henry's got her left calf heavily strapped. She missed the start of the season because of that calf injury. So perhaps not at 100% as they bring it in under the post. And their first opportunity to score here through Catherine Latu. And the Mystics are on the scoreboard.
Oh, there's that movement from Latu. Took Geitz to the top of the circle. Quick roll back to the baseline. Opened up some impressive space.
Catherine Latu, the second most accurate shooter in the league, shooting at 90%. Amy Steele with a little fumble. Now the Firebirds. Nurse to Wall. This is where they've had problems in the last few weeks. Trying to feed it in under the post. Don't have too many problems if you just keep putting it in high like that, Liz.
It's a perfect feed. But in order to do that, you've got to work the ball onto the edge of the circle. That makes it, it's a difficult game to play.
Latu backs herself in. Almost the offensive rebound.
Goal defense contact.
So Maria Tutayet, and her first goal for the evening, and they've pegged it back to one goal margin. So we have a look at the penalties already.
Well, there's been plenty of whistle in this match. Seen that across the course of this weekend.
Maybe the umpire's got a pep talk last week in the lead up to round four, Liz. Heavily involved. So too is Latu. Early stages. Oh, rare miss from her.
A bad miss too.
Yeah, we mentioned she's shooting at 90%, second most accurate in the league, so the misses are rare. patient on the build-up and then just fires in a bullet-like pass to Aiken. Well, a fresh airing.
Fresh air. She didn't even hit the post. So that was a replay. Well, not her Aiken. Doesn't look to be comfortable in her shot.
Re-attack contact.
Again, a penalty against the run of play. She's changing the momentum of the game.
Well, there's just a brief pause in play. Let's get down to our courtside commentator, Vicky Wilson. Vicky, have you seen the opening?
Well, the Mystics started off just a little bit tentative, and I think that's because Tamapara George really was being smothered by Claire McMiniman, but towards the latter part, started to find that space, get herself onto that edge of the circle, and did some great double plays with Jenny May Coffin.
Another miss from Aiken, so 3 from 6, and Byfield reads it beautifully, and they're away now, the Mystics.
Well, Byfield, one of the leading intercept takers in the league, and you can see why. Just reads play perfectly. Timing's great. Athleticism as well.
To Tyer in full flight. And a replay here of Byfield, the Jamaican defender. Saw that coming a mile off.
Vantage offside goal attack.
So
Vantage offside centre.
Quite a few misses already, Liz. We're only halfway through the opening quarter.
Those 3 misses from the Firebirds, all coming from Romelda Aiken. She's had 6 attempts. Generally, she does rebound her shot very well, but she's under plenty of pressure tonight in that department from Byfield and Henry.
And the 2 Jamaicans go at it again. Oh, Byfield doing really well, but the call's gone against her. And another miss here for the home side.
Just while we're waiting for the ball to come back, Vic, I want to ask you, what, in your opinion, is going on with Romelda Aitken's shot?
Well, I don't think there's actually too much technically wrong with the shot. I think it's more that just being settled by the rest of her teammates. And, you know, that's where Tams in Greenway last year, she played a very big role. She was constantly talking to Romelda, as did Alyssa Kostrisos. So she really does need that support around her all the time.
And obviously Liz as well. Oh, that's a beautiful ball that comes in onto the baseline. Latu.
Contact wing. You pull it out, wing.
Different coach obviously this year as well, so a different game plan and really encouraging Aiken to leave the circle. It's something different and perhaps has backfired so far.
Look, it's a tough one to call, particularly because Aiken is so good when she's under the post. But when you've got a player who can cut and drive like Nat Medhurst can, you do want to make sure you're opening space for her as well.
We saw a cut and drive then, but it didn't come off. So a little mini run here from the visitors, the Northern Mystics. 6 of the last 8 goals.
Both teams having to use a lot of passes to get the ball down court. That's testament to the really strong defensive effort from both defensive lines.
Firebird shooting just 56% in this opening quarter, so really racked of all confidence under their post. Different story though for the Mystics as they edge ahead. Firebirds put the first 3 on the board. The New Zealand side has hit back. Well picked off by Sarah Wall. Really need to score as they search for it again. Byfield, eyes on the ball, cannons into the advertising hoardings.
That's commitment. That is total commitment to the ball and to the intercept. Love to see it.
Sarah Wall did not know what had hit her. She just crashed in and Byfield goes again. She is up and about. It's exciting to watch.
Just gives me goosebumps seeing a player just defend like that, committing to everything, jumping up, having a go.
And one finally drops for Aiken. Here's Sarah Wall. She saw out of the corner of her eye Byfield charging at her. Give her nightmares.
That's great to watch too. Romelda Aiken in full flight. Much better placement from Lauren Nurse.
So 5 minutes left in this opening quarter and we're all tied up as well. Almost a shot dropped from the halfway mark.
Well, there's a fastnet competition at the end of the year in England that would have counted for 2 points had it gone in. That rule doesn't apply though to the ANZ Championships.
Aiken took it beautifully, dropped beautifully. Let's get back down to our courtside reporter, Vicky Wilson, as Aitken looks to take control.
Well, the Firebirds are starting to find their rhythm in the forward line, in particular through Sarah Wall. When she goes out uncontested on that first ball, she just links up beautifully with Lauren Nurse. So that's where Wilcox really needs to step up the contest.
Thanks, Vicky. To Makara George. Risky. Latu, a settler for the visitors.
It was well worked then. Latu set up a beautiful screen, strong enough to screen out both defensive players, and then clever enough to pop out for the little pass.
There's Meghurst with a clever little pass herself. Bounces out to Aitken. A chance to mop up for Meghurst. Nothing in this first quarter.
Lead
seesawing. Latu scores her fifth from seven attempts.
That is great wing attack.
Meghurst, a bit of Nurse, goes the high ball. Gives Byfield a really good look at it. She pumps it back to Nurse.
Normally sticking up a ball like that with that sort of air underneath it, that would go over most defenders. Byfield, though, just has this beautiful vertical jump. She's able to contest any sort of pass like that.
Meghurst with four from five. Shot just eight from 15 attempts last week at 53% against her former side, the Adelaide Thunderbirds.
Advantage offside.
That's the first miss of the night for Maria Tutaier. They get the result they need, and their coach is pretty happy with it. So the Firebirds have put up more attempts this quarter. And they're out to a two-goal lead. 2 minutes left, first stanza.
Obstruction, advantage offside.
And the umpire with plenty to say, Liz. She nods. George, over the top, Latu, too much on it. Just overcooked that pass.
It's a rare mistake from Temapara George. She's really accurate with her placement of the pass from the edge of the circle. The Romelda Aitken shot that one with one foot in the air, perhaps. That's worth, well, I've got no idea what that was for.
The result is Meghurst with a sweet shot.
See Aitken off balance.
Yeah, she knew the long arm was coming. Oh, Latu.
Crucial shot for the Mystics. They've got to stay in touch with the Firebirds.
Minute left, long ball in under the post. And you'd think Aitken, Byfield took the points early in this quarter, but Aitken just pegging her back. It's a crucial matchup. Probably about 30 all, you'd have to say, Liz, heading into quarter time.
Yeah, Aitken doing well. She's being brought back into the contest, though, by some really good service from the feeders out in front of her. Nat Meghurst, in particular, is starting to find her really well. It's great to see Meghurst getting the ball, and her first look is to the post to see where her shooting partner is.
Contact win.
Forced to go backwards. Good defensive pressure here being applied by the Firebirds. Can they get a score before quarter time? They need to stay in touch. And Tutaier sinks her fifth goal for the quarter.
That was just clever, patient play then from the Mystics. And Lauren Nurse unfortunately got rid of the ball early. It will be a Mystic centre pass when we return from this quarter. really an interesting battle in this shooting line. Romelda Aiken starting off slowly. Althea Byfield, so impressive for the Mystics, was up and at everything. Firebirds, though, as Vicky Wilson said, started to find their rhythm towards the end of that quarter, got out to a handy lead. This game is in a really precarious position for both teams.
It's the Firebirds out to a 3-goal lead over the Northern Mystics. Well, the Queensland Firebirds looking for their first win of the year, and they lead by 3 goals over the Northern Mystics, the team from Auckland, in this final clash for round four. It's been a real seesawing start to this game, Liz Ellis.
Certainly has. Firebirds shooting percentages just down a little bit from the Mystics. The Mystics, though, generally get plenty of accurate shooting from Catherine Latu. Just look at these penalties, contact and obstruction, lots of whistle. Mystics defenders, Jolene Henry, said earlier in the week she expected a lot of whistle in this game based on just what she sort of heard across the Tasman last week, and she's certainly getting it.
3 lead changes in the opening quarter, and Aiken and Medhurst leading the way in the forward line for the Firebirds.
Yeah, just look at this shot chart. Just to the left of the post is where Romelda Aiken is doing all of her damage. She's getting some great ball there. Not really dominating the middle of the court. She's leaving that for Nat Medhurst, but it's just down around that baseline. Althea Byfield needs to just work her around that baseline, not allow her to be comfortable. She's starting to find a little niche there.
The Silver Fern captain, Temapara George, that gets proceedings underway in the second quarter, which Vicky Wilson means there's been a few changes.
Well, Jenny May Coffin didn't last very long, so she's been benched, and Grace Rasmussen has been brought out to wing attack, resulting in George moving through the centre. And really, that's where Tiora Keenan really did spend a lot of time, just talking to the midcourt, talking to Grace Rasmussen, telling her to get involved, not spend her time out on the sidelines.
Here's Nurse, the captain for the Firebirds. So the two captains going head-to-head in the centre position.
Yeah, and that's a clever move from Keenan, the Mystics coach, particularly given that Claire McMenamin was really a smothering force on top of Temapara George. Clever move to get George away from McMenamin. That may free her up for some attacking moves down the court. She's also a fairly handy defender.
So the Mystics with the first score. Ball goes against Henry.
Just come forward a little bit, Goldie.
See Jolene Henry's left calf heavily strapped. She hasn't been in the game really at all. So what a centre pass receives, a couple of deflections, but no intercepts, no rebounds, no penalties, which is unusual.
It was a monster ball into Latu. Now George, Nurse is going to make her work for it. There's the heavily strapped left calf of Jolene Henry.
Yeah, it almost looks like she's limping a bit. She just isn't having the same impact that she normally has on a match.
Well, she crossed over in the summer and missed the opening half of the Mystics season opener with that injury. So you'd be thinking a new team, new club, wanting to impress and get out there on the court. So perhaps playing under a little duress. Forced wide on this movement forward, the Firebirds. Medhurst regularly doesn't miss too many, just the one miss for the night so far. Guides all over Latu then, and Latu knew it. She wasn't happy with it whatsoever.
Yeah. Looked like a little dance. I thought they were doing the Jo-Ho curl.
It was, wasn't it, Liz? You know all about dancing. Look at Latu's face. Yeah, don't do that again, thanks. She's getting under her skin, which is what all good defenders do. Aiken. She's falling a little short. Well, a little unorthodox, but it was effective.
And when shots fall short, it often is a confidence thing. Not the confidence to push through with your follow through.
She can be costly. Liz, she gives away a a lot of penalties.
She does. I thought she was unlucky then. She was simply contesting the ball. The penalty didn't have to be blown. Made no difference to the game. Latu is a strong competitor. She'll take that ball with two hands.
Yeah, Guyatt's the highest penalised player in the league so far with 52. Having said that, she leads the rebounds with 21. So Byfield just getting in the face of Aiken. Remembering, of course, that they are Jamaican teammates. So another one for Medhurst. Coaching staff at the Firebirds like it. Still a three-goal lead to the home side. It was three goals at quarter time. Maria Tutaier. They need to remain in touch, and they do. The Northern Mystics. Really good encounter unfolding here in Brisbane. Vicky Wilson is courtside. Vicky.
Well, it's interesting to see the defensive pattern that the Mystics are running. It's getting a little bit lost, trying to force the centre pass to go back, but we really do need Jolene Henry sitting back on Medhurst, because Medhurst has come back into this game nice and strong.
I knew Medhurst would be up for a big game. Wants to rebound after her shocker against the Adelaide Thunderbirds last week. Good ball to Wall. Now Aiken again. So the Firebirds starting to get on top ever so slowly here in Brisbane, searching for their first win of the year.
It's better ball movement between the Mystics. Centre court players playing a little typical New Zealand triangle, working the angles, getting the ball into the middle of the circle. No, Larissa Wilcox takes no prisoners in defence. And she nearly took Sarah Wall's head while she was at it. Really impressive play from Medhurst. Just what she did then. She almost hid in behind Aiken and just popped out at the last minute. She would have been stinging all week to get back on court just to make up for the loss last week, and particularly the fact that she faded out of the game. She's particularly harsh on herself.
So goal for goal in this second quarter, really not much in it whatsoever. Still a three-goal ball game. They share it around. Just get the feeling there's the intensity has stepped up a little bit.
Certainly has. Mystics in particular have come out and they're just moving the ball a little bit better than they did in that first quarter.
Just a little bit more physical. Henry not happy with that call. Medhurst gives it over to Aiken, and another goal for the Firebirds. And they get possession, so a chance to make it the biggest lead of the match so far. And they'll do that through Romelda Aiken. It's the Firebirds by five.
One of the problems that the Mystics defence line is having is that because they play that zone style of defence, no one is up with hands over the feeder. That gives them a really clear view into Romelda Aiken, makes the delivery of the ball that much easier. If you watch what the Firebirds are doing against the Mystics, they're up right over and in the face of the person with the ball. That's why they're finding it a little difficult sometimes to find Latu.
She's been unstoppable so far, Catherine Latu. 2010 ANZ Championship.
Vantage contact wing.
Just a little bit of miscommunication there.
Oh, Wilcox likely to come up with that call. To go her way, she would have given possession away for stepping.
George Tutaier. Oh, again, a little bit happening off.
Oh, yeah, plenty of push and shove going on there. Latu, the one who was penalised, but all four were giving as good as they got.
So it's getting pretty rough in under the post down the Mystics end. Meanwhile, up the Firebirds end, Romelda Aiken is just starting to ooze more confidence.
Yeah, well done, guys. Oh,
did all the hard work.
Well, she'll get the stat, but it'll be matched by a turnover stat, unfortunately. She's just read that beautifully.
Let's go back down courtside. Vicky Wilson.
Well, the Mystics really do need Tutaia to lift a work rate, particularly out the front. Rasmussen's getting caught nice and deep in the pockets. I think they need to start coming through the middle of the court to give that direct entry through to Latu.
And Geitz makes it look easy, Liz, but they're hard to do.
They certainly are. The risk, of course, being that if you miss it, you've left the goal shooter home alone under the post. Might be a good movie, but it's not a good thing to do when you're a goalkeeper.
And Geitz just having a chat there to her defensive partner in crime, Amy Steele, as there's an injury timeout called. Temapara George just getting a little work done to her left calf muscle there. We'd see Amy Steele there on screen. Liz, what can you tell us a little bit about her? Obviously, a former Victorian, played, came on, I think, for one game last year for the Vixens and played a quarter, but has spent the last couple of years through the AIS as we have a look at Natalie Medhurst's stats.
Yeah, Natalie Medhurst is a player who sometimes you just want to get her and say, put it together for four quarters. She's had two or one and a half pretty good quarters so far. Just look at the goal assists. She's had five. She's right up there with her rest of her teammates, with Sarah Wall and Lauren Nurse for goal assists. That's great that she's turning and looking towards Romelda Aiken. That's her first look. That's got to be her job as goal attack. Really active as well in the centre pass receive. She's picked up seven of those. Sarah Wall's picked up 10, so they're sharing the load evenly. Medhurst, of course, have only missed the one goal. If she can mirror this effort in the second half, she'll go close to picking up the three votes for the Holden Cruz Player of the Year. It's sort of thing you want to see Nat Medhurst do. But you're talking about Amy Steelkel. She's a player who's played a lot of goalkeeper in her time and is really learning the craft of the goal defence position. Rosalie Jenke, her coach for the Firebirds, is the perfect person to learn that off. I'd actually like to see her do a little bit more of the one-on-one work, trying to hold up the goal attack's entry into the circle. She sometimes wants to sit back into the circle and play almost like a second goalkeeper.
Called up into the Australian squad when Laura Geitz actually injured her hand at the end of last year. So some good experience for the youngster. Relishing her time starting for her new team, the Queensland Firebirds. Bit of confusion down here. Let's go courtside, Vicky Wilson.
Well, there's confusion all around for the Mystics. It was Temapara George who called time. She must be involved in the substitution. And they brought on Kayla Cullen to goal defence. So it's confusion all around. Jolene Henry has to have to move into the centre. Now they've been pulled up for delay. So it's they don't know what's going on here.
So it could prove costly in a critical time of the match.
Yeah, that's a really basic rule that the Mystics coaching staff should have been aware of.
Sarah Wall just gets up close and personal with one of the spectators here. And as a result of that error in judgment, the Firebirds skip out to a six-goal lead. So this is now their biggest lead in the game.
Yeah, as Vic said,
and picked off by Medhurst. She's really starting to take this game by the scruff of the neck.
She certainly is. As Vic said, the player who calls time must be involved in the substitution. Temapara George called time. She wasn't involved in the substitution. So before play could be restarted, she needed to change position somewhere along the line. Jolene Henry, of course, doing the right thing now, calling time. She and Temapara George will switch bibs and she'll be involved in the substitution.
Chaos on centre court in Brisbane, just taking a while to sort themselves out.
Yeah, and as it turns out, Jolene Henry going to the bench, she does not look comfortable. It's a shame for the Mystics because she is a really effective defensive player for them.
We'll get Vicky to keep an eye on her and whether she does get any treatment for that heavily strapped left calf. Geitz in front, unlucky. Fast and furious in under the post. And they remain in touch. Vicky, Jolene Henry, how's she looking?
Well, she's looking fine. I just think she came off just to get it all sorted out so they could get Temapara George back into the middle. I was surprised they actually waited a couple of centre passes before they called time because they were well within their right after the whistle had blown to just call time immediately.
It's a funny old rule, and the umpires really can't not let you call time, even though it's obvious that you're doing it tactically, because they've got a duty of care in case someone is really injured. To add insult to injury, someone's put Larissa Wilcox's bib on upside down. It's generally a trick that you like to play on your teammates. Well, Mystics are coming back.
They certainly are. It's back to five goals. And I saw the game Saturday afternoon in Sydney. The Swifts trailing the Pulse at halftime, and they came out and put on the first 10 goals in the third quarter. So it could change in the blink of an eye. And a chance for two in a row for the visitors. Latu delivers. Take by Wall, just couldn't keep it in play.
And if you're going to plot where the last three times the Firebirds have turned the ball over, it's right there where that throwing is being taken right now. Just got to be careful not to try and force the long ball when it's not on. Just work the ball, be patient.
So Byfield to Wilcox. Over to George.
Important play here for the Mystics. They can score here or get them back into the game.
This is Wilcox. George to Tyer.
Contact centre outside. Contact ball defence. Yeah, no, with the goal attack.
Amy still trying that old trick of stepping back, saying, no, I was here when I committed the penalty. You're always trying to make the shooters take a longer shot. Basic error there. Tutoye just needed to be a lot more aggressive on that take. She was really casual in just bending down to her feet. Got to get there with two hands.
And they can't afford to throw it away, Liz. They're trail by three.
It wasn't the best place pass, but it was certainly well within range.
Both sides really playing for a lot tonight.
We have a towel.
As the towel's called onto centre court.
Yeah, Sharon Kelly just found a slippery spot.
As we mentioned, a lot at stake, particularly for the Northern Mystics. I mean, they really are top four contenders. They've got to make two trips to Australia throughout the season. This is their first one, and then they come back next week to play the Vixens in Melbourne next Monday night. You just get the feeling if they can break the hoodoo, win on Australian soil tonight, then top four is a reality for them.
Yeah, it starts to look pretty good. Lose tonight, and it starts to get a whole lot harder. Just watch that. Might have been in her knees, and she's a tall girl, but you've got to get down and get those, particularly if you're a silver fern. She's an outstanding athlete. She's got the ability to get to them.
Well, Tutoye struggling to get down to the ball, but no problems for Romelda Aitken getting up to the ball. That just puts it back out to five goals. Oh, just a little bit too much on it.
Yeah, a little bit too much and too soon. I'd like to see Mystics just work the ball to the edge of the circle. Just to be able to deliver the ball from within safer range.
Crucial couple of minutes coming up before the main break as the long ball goes into Aitken. No confidence to shoot that.
She's off balance. So Firebirds fortunate to come up with possession.
Now six goals. Vicky Wilson courtside.
Well, the Firebirds have started playing a split circle defensive pattern in the circle with Steele coming back on Latu. And I'm surprised that Tutoye hasn't picked it up a little bit earlier, that they're floating back. So she should be starting back just to drag them off Latu and involve herself more around the top of the circle.
Firebirds have scored the last three straight goals. A little bit of breathing space before half time. You know, the Mystics need to score. Double teamed was Latu from the baseline. Really needs this to lift her side, and it drops. So five goal ball game, and they have possession. And the long ball comes into Latu. She could have spun around from mid range instead.
Oh, and they're doing her best to run that clock down. Important shot here for Tutoye.
And the Mystics are back in touch. Can they get a stop before the main break? This game really in the balance. It's been a real arm wrestle. Opening half, beautiful pass. A lovely cut to the post from Medhurst.
Yeah, Medhurst steamed in from well outside the circle. Just runs those beautiful angles. There is time for Latu.
And she puts it up. Ooh. And the rebound is from Guides. And after the Firebirds leading by three at quarter time, they extend it ever so slightly, and at half time, the game well and truly in the balance. It's the Queensland Firebirds by 5-32, leading the Northern Mystics 27. Stick around, we've got a game on our hands, the second half coming up right after this.
Well, it's a pretty thrilling encounter here. Rough and tumble, lot of whistle. Players doing their best to work their way around it. Firebirds, though, just having the run of play at the moment, a little bit of extra momentum going their way, despite the fact that Althea Byfield has thrown herself into this match.
She certainly has. It's been fantastic to watch here courtside as we have a look at some of the match stats up until half time. And this is a real scrap, Liz. There really isn't in this at all.
Certainly isn't. Just look at those intercept stats. Plenty of ball being grabbed hold of by the defensive players from both teams. Rebounds not particularly high, and that's because the shooting is impressive from both teams. Firebirds in particular have picked up on that in the first half.
Well, let's have a look at some of the first half highlights. Plenty to talk about. It really is a grueling battle. It was the Firebirds by three at quarter time and out to five at the half, and Medhurst has been in everything.
She certainly has. One of the best on court so far for the Firebirds. As we keep saying, though, the onus is on her to be able to produce that sort of form for the full 60 minutes. If she can do that, Firebirds, of course, right in this. Althea Byfield, impressive early, but just started to give Romelda Aiken a little too much room as her first half wore on, and the Firebirds able to find plenty of space.
And we see Tutai Air, who has been involved. Usually, the last couple of weeks, Latu's been really the go-to girl, but it's pretty even if we have a look at the shooting stats. They've gone 50-50.
They have. Tutai Air needs to probably try and inject herself a little bit further into the circle, inject herself a little bit more into the game. Just not be content to sit out of the circle and act as a third feeder. The Mystics in particular really need her to be in there in the circle and driving hard.
Can we expect the Firebirds coach, Rosalie Jenke, to make too many changes in this second half?
No, wouldn't. The Firebirds are just starting to look comfortable, and they're starting to look as if they're placing the ball well to Aiken. Their defence are getting their hand on plenty of ball. The centre court's running smoothly. I wouldn't change it.
Well, the Firebirds have got plenty to play for, still searching for their first win in season 2010. There's nothing in it. They lead the Mystics by 5 goals at half-time right after this. The second half, not too far away. We've got a good game on our hands. Well, an absorbing struggle unfolding in this round four encounter in Brisbane. It is the Queensland Firebirds 32 leading the Northern Mystics 27 as we get ready to get the third quarter underway. And it's Nurse, the captain for the Queensland Firebirds, with the opening centre pass. Liz Ellis, rivalry round. And I have some good news to tell you, that the Aussies are leading the Kiwis by 46 goals at this point in time. The Vixens did win over the Tasman earlier tonight. So if we do the maths, the Mystics tonight need to win by 47 goals to win rivalry round.
That would mean they've got a 53-goal turnaround ahead of them.
Maths is your strong point. You have lots of strong points. Vicky Wilson courtside, a couple of changes.
Well, I'm surprised for the Mystics that they've left Kayla Cullen out there, because really she is very inexperienced, and Medhurst just came into the game so much in that last quarter. So if Medhurst doesn't shoot at least 10 goals this game or this quarter, you'd have to say there's something wrong, because she really is just running all over Kayla Cullen.
Well, she shot 9 from 10 in that second quarter. So the challenge is there.
Vicky's put it out there. 10 goals in a quarter for Natalie Medhurst. You're talking up your maths. You better get the calculator ready. Wilcox for the Mystics.
As long as it's simple addition, Kel.
A fumble. Time to regather for George.
Mystics really need to come into this match with, or this quarter in particular, with a huge amount of intensity. They've got to lift their rating, they've got to lift their work rate. lift their scoring rate, defensively be a lot more aggressive if they're going to make up this six-goal deficit.
As Medhurst is knocked to the deck by a new opponent. Steadies. First two for Medhurst. Really starting to flex her muscles now, Natalie Medhurst. Point to prove coming in here tonight. It was an ambitious long ball, but it pays off. Another miss for Aiken. Has a miss on the second attempt. And three in a row for the Firebirds. I mentioned earlier, Liz, that the Swifts came out and just blew the pulse away at the start of the third quarter. 10 in a row.
Contact offside center.
We don't want to see that happen here tonight for the New Zealand side. To Tyer with a long, sweet bomb.
Just looking at the penalty stats, even from both teams, they're both copping the same amount of whistle. There's a lot of whistle in the game. It seems to have just staunched a little bit at the moment. We're seeing a lot more flow. Enjoyable to watch.
So the deficit now is 8. Guyatt's cops one high. She's gone toe-to-toe with Latu all evening. To Tyer, with another from long range. Makes it look easy. Maria to Tyer, 14 from 15. Aiken. Still not quite confident to put it up from mid-range. Looking to give it off. Now she gets it in and under.
She's getting pretty good service from Lauren Nurse in this quarter. Nat Medhurst is there to just scoop up the remnants. Guides again.
To Nurse, and they're away. To Medhurst. This hurt. Third for the quarter. Vicky Wilson might have called it.
Well, Aiken starting to find her space in that circle nicely. She's got herself on the move, just working on that repositioning, muscling up a little bit on Byfield. In fact, I'd have to say that Byfield is very quiet. She's been a little bit sloppy with her footwork, not moving around and getting in that front spot.
Yeah, she started particularly well, Byfield, and that was when she did have, she was up on the toes, bouncing around. As the game's gone on, she's started to sit back on her heels a little bit more, and she's not really attacking the ball like she was in the first quarter.
I think it's Larissa Wilcox who might have called the injury timeout, Liz, as we have a look at the head-to-head comparisons.
Well, Catherine Latu is having a pretty good game. She's not getting the level of service from her feeders that Romelda Aiken is. She's probably committed a couple more sins in terms of penalties and turnovers. But Romelda Aiken is building into this match, but it's just that level of confidence on the shot that she needs her teammates to give her plenty of talk, plenty of support, keep talking to her. But you think that she's got the points in the battle of the goal shooters at the moment.
Well, yeah, you're right. Aiken really starting to find her feet.
And just watching her body language. She skipped back onto the court just then. She's starting to look a little bit happier.
And enjoying it more.
Yeah, she's an open book in terms of just watching her. You tend to know what she's feeling just by watching her.
Well, she's been almost brought to tears out on court the last couple of times they've played. They've lost and she's been quite visibly distressed. So you're right about the body language. There she is, bouncing around on her toes and gets it again. As they start to edge clear, it's the Firebirds out by 10, Vicky.
Well, I think if Tarora Keenan looks to her right, she might actually put me on the court because she's just subbing so many people on. Now we've got Jolene Henry back out at wing defence. So I was right, there was nothing wrong with Henry originally. That's why I was surprised she didn't rejig that line going into this second half.
She's not that desperate, Vicky.
Firebirds. They sense that their star Jamaican goal shooter is up and about, so they're really looking to go to her.
Interesting that Jolene Henry's back on court. I'm surprised, though, that she's not on at goal defence to try and staunch the flow of goals and playmaking from Nat Medhurst. Henry's the most experienced defender out there. You want her on the player who's causing the most damage to you, and that at the moment is Medhurst.
Carly Cullen coming on at goal defence, the teenage defender. Big task for her. Tyer just falls short.
The other thing that I'd like to see from the Mystics is maybe a change up in their defensive pattern. They've persisted with this zone style of defence, which hasn't really put any pressure on the feeder, which is what you need to do when you've got someone trying to pass a high ball into a tall shooter.
And they're starting to dominate now, the Firebirds. So they're going high, Aitken with the cut. She gets another chance through an offensive rebound. And all of a sudden, they can smell their first victory for the year.
You do get the feeling with this Firebirds team, they're still a relatively young side, despite the expectations that have been put on them. They can get a win under their belt, just learn how to win. They'll build their season from here. Long way to go, though. They're up against a bit of a wily side in the Mystics. There's plenty of smart players in this team. They're not out of it by any stretch of the imagination.
Well, the Mystics pushed the Magic last week all the way. So they're coming off a big game. And as we said earlier, plenty at stake for both sides, particularly the Mystics. They've got the top four in their sights. Realistic top four contenders.
Traction wing defense.
So George gets to feed it in, Latu. Too quick for Geitz on that occasion. And after fading out of the game, Latu now with 17 from 20 attempts. Tutair is 15 from 17 attempts. Byfield, good defensive pressure, one-on-one under the post. The lead to 12. So Henry to Latu. It was ambitious and Geitz put it down for the rebound. Medhurst a chance to make it 13. It is a 13. Goal margin, and we see Geitz on screen. This Geitz teaming with Steele. Have you seen that defensive partnership?
Yeah, look, it's been pretty good. Steele's done a really good job in making sure that whenever Maria Tutoya has the ball in her hand, she doubles back and helps Geitz with Latu. So they've done a pretty good job. Where they have been incredibly helped, though, is Clement Menemann is having a fine game. She's taken first George out of the game when she played wing attack, now Rasmussen out of the game. Neither of the wing attacks that have played have had any sort of impact on the match in that position. That's drawn Tutoyer up the court and just made Steele's job that little bit easier.
On your jump.
Yeah, it's always the way with the wing defence. We never give them too much credit, do we? But did it. Got the potential to form a pretty dominant defensive trio.
Often the most athletic player in your team is your wing defence because it's a thankless position. She's got a lot of work to do off the ball. You also need someone who's a really potent attacking player. Simone McInnes was the original player like that. Selena Gilsonen, much the same. There's a footwork call then against the Mystics.
We'll score this quarter if Medhurst puts this in, makes it 15-6. So we always refer to the third quarter as the premiership quarter, and they've really put their foot down, the Firebirds, in this third term.
Well, speaking to Rosalie Jenke, the Firebirds coach, during the week, Kel, one thing that she pointed out was in their first three matches that they lost, they actually won two quarters in each of those matches. So she just felt the ability to beat teams over a 15-minute period was there. It's just a matter of putting those periods together. And if you have a quarter that you lose, you just can't lose it too badly.
Going to Aitken again. Vicky Wilson, it's been a pretty dominant display in this third quarter.
Well, they really have put their foot to the floor, the Firebirds, and they've found their confidence. They've got their rhythm back. And I think, you know, with the way the Mystics are playing at the moment, they're just scrambling. They're not contesting any ball. Medhurst is having a field day, and Cullen really is out of the league out there at the moment.
seen some pretty interesting coaching moves this round. The Pulse led the Swifts in Sydney at half time, and then the coaching staff decided to make wholesale changes, and then a similar situation here tonight with the Mystics coaching staff making some pretty interesting changes that have raised a few eyebrows when the side's been in the lead.
They'll also need to go back and have a good look at the rule book. That just gobsmacks me that you don't know the rules if you're coaching at this level in terms of the substitution. Whoever calls time must be involved in the substitution.
Here's the goal attempt, so it really just starting to show the dominance there, that statistic, 58 to 40. Just over 3 minutes left in this third quarter. Game was in the balance up until the half. Mystics desperately need to go on a little mini
Vantage
run here.
Vantage center. Vantage center obstruction. Vantage contact.
Quick hands there from
contact
George and Latu.
Sorry,
now to Tyre. And this star shooting combination drag the Northern Mystics back into this contest. It's Firebirds by 15. Don't forget, Liz, rivalry round. The Mystics need to win by 47. I've been told you need to talk that up.
I saved my credibility for a day when I need it.
It looks like the Aussies might have pipped the Kiwis in rivalry round.
Well, Australia won it last year, but only just. It was only after a really impressive win from the Vixens over the Tactics in Melbourne. New Zealand were leading rivalry round into the last game last year, and there was plenty of pundits around who thought that this game might decide it, but it's well and truly over, I think.
It's a great initiative by the ANZ Championship. It's basically, obviously, the Aussie teams playing the Kiwi teams in round four, and they collate the scores in total, and as a result, the Aussies are well and truly leading. The Firebirds edging towards their first win of the season.
See Claire McMenamin's attack down court then. That's what I was talking about before. The wing defence is so vital often in setting up the attacking play. You need your wing defence to bring the ball to the shooting or the goal third transverse line just so that you don't drag your wing attack and your goal attack up too high. Claire McMenamin tonight has been so impressive in that regard.
And with that goal to Natalie Medhurst, that is 10 for the quarter. So Vicky Wilson is our special commentator in tonight, and she has called it beautifully. She predicted that Medhurst
center obstruction
would take control in this third term. Tipped she'd score 10 goals, and she's done just that.
Well, so I'm sure Vicky's hoping that she stops scoring now, so that she's right.
Advantage obstruction.
So we've got a minute, just under a minute 20 left, and Medhurst can't score a goal, so our
Advantage
special comments
on the ball, goal attack.
Look expert. George to Latu, no. Now to Tyre, off the foot of Amy Steele.
Oh, to Tyre. So unlucky then, she stepped through. Perhaps should have got the penalty call. The ball was kicked out of her hand by Geitz.
Looking to put it beyond reach. Medhurst for her 11th of the quarter. And they're out to a 15 goal lead.
Vicky Wilson shaking her head, she's not happy.
Wing defence, goal third.
Just amazing. Momentum in sport is just such an amazing thing.
Advantage,
when everything's going your way, it is really going your way. Just to bounce the ball going the Firebirds' way at the moment.
Wing defence, contact, advantage offside.
Well, it was really goal for goal in the opening half. The Firebirds got the first three of the night. And rather, the Mystics got the first. The Firebirds got the first three of the night. The Mystics hit back. They hit the lead in the opening quarter as a long ball looks to go into Aitken. Byfield all over that, playing in front with the intercept.
I was about to say they've got to go long. Didn't quite get it. Well, some problems for the Mystics. Firebirds piling on 20 goals in that quarter. Could this be a record score for them? Really impressive stuff from the Firebirds defensive line, but Nat Medhurst coming into this game beautifully, really controlling the front line for the Firebirds, distributing the ball but also finding herself well and truly in the goals. It's good to see a player like Medhurst getting involved and taking this game by the scruff of the neck. So far it is the Firebirds by 14 here in Brisbane.
For the Queensland Firebirds, just one quarter away from their first breakthrough victory of the season after losing their first three. But the Northern Mystics have got other ideas. They trail by 14 goals at three-quarter time as we crunch the numbers with Liz Ellis.
There's plenty of numbers to crunch. Both shoot teams shooting beautifully. It is the attempts, the amount of ball that the Firebirds have had, which has been really impressive. They're getting a lot of ball back through intercepts and rebounds from their defensive line, but they're also making the most of it. Most importantly, though, they've only had 9 turnovers to the Mystics' 15. You cannot afford to cough the ball up, and the Firebirds have probably been a little bit guilty of that in recent games. Tonight, though, really slick.
And Claire McMenamin, you've been talking about her quite a bit tonight, Liz. She's impressed you.
She has, but just look at these stats. No intercepts, no offside, which is good for a wing defence, and 10 penalties. One turnover, one deflection. It's sometimes hard to play well as a wing defence, and for that playing well to come up in the statistics, I guess, is what I'm trying to say. She's doing a fine job. She just doesn't have a lot of numbers next to her name. That's because most of what she's doing is just cutting off space, cutting off play, generally making a pest of herself.
They're good at doing that, the wing defence. Well, the Northern Mystics continue to hang around. Will they hang in long enough? Start of the fourth quarter, Vicky Wilson.
Another change for the Mystics with Finau Palu coming on at wing defence and Larissa Wilcox having a rest. But at least we've got Jolene Henry back on Medhurst. So this will be a real test for Medhurst now. But, you know, the Firebirds have that confidence in that forward line. They're moving nicely. They're getting the ball close to the circle edge and delivering the ball well into Aiken.
And on cue, Aiken delivers. Up to 15 goals. I think Vicky Wilson might be speaking too loud over that side of the court, Liz. The Mystics coaching staff can hear her. Everything she says, they do.
Well, she did coach the Firebirds for a couple of years, so they do well to just keep their ear to what she's saying.
A rebound and a goal for Romelda Aitken and a wry smile. Been a tough old night for Byfield. Started in a blaze of glory, struggled to get her hands on the ball too much since.
And in her defence, it's really hard when the ball's screaming down the court, and that has been the case a lot of times tonight. The Mystics' defensive line out in front of her haven't got their hands up, they haven't disrupted the flow into the circle.
Latu, body language isn't too great. They do peg one back. They need to get a run. They need to find a spark.
Hopefully they've set themselves a couple of goals in this quarter. They may have looked at the scoreline and thought, right, we can't win this, but there are certain things we can achieve. And that's what you do when you're down by a number of goals. You just look at little things that you can do through the game that you can look back in your reflections and say, okay, well, good in this area. We achieved a couple of things we wanted to.
A big week for them coming up as well. They fly back to Auckland and then back to Australia, to Melbourne next Monday night to play the Vixens. So it doesn't get any tougher. It's a tough fortnight for them.
Yeah, it is. And it's one of those things that a lot of the teams in the first couple of years of this ANZ Championship have tried to figure out whether they, when you've got 2 games in a row, if you're an Australian team in New Zealand or a New Zealand team in Australia, do you stay here for the week? Do you go back home and deal with the travel, but at least get back to your home base for a couple of days? Mystics have obviously decided on the ladder. A couple of years ago, Pulse stayed over here and they struggled. It was just a long week for them. And it's a long week if you lose your first game as well.
And they're starting to put on a show for their fans now, the Queensland Firebirds. They sense victory. It's been a long time coming. It's a long ball coming. Latu does well to keep it in play.
Yeah, she's got fantastic skills. Great control and great balance. You know, just when you think she's going to fall out of court, puts the brakes on and holds the ground.
Yeah, course, the Firebirds were pre-season premiers, and many experts had tipped them to go all the way this year, so it was a real shock. They lost their first three games. A little unlucky last week against the Thunderbirds, went down just by the one. So a big win will do their confidence wonders.
And it will also do their percentages wonders. They haven't had massive losses. Their biggest loss was to the Vixens. Just went down by one last week and only a handful of goals to the Swifts a few weeks before. So a big win like this and the percentage points that come with it may hold them in good stead at the end of the season.
Can they go from the bottom of the ladder to the top? It'll be enthralling to watch throughout this season. Back down to Vicky courtside.
Well, I think the important thing about this victory for the Firebirds is their high scoring rate. They've only sat in the mid-40s for the first three games, so they'll take a lot of confidence out of this one. Interesting to see Wall and Nurse swap positions. Nurse is far more comfortable sitting back on that wing attack role. She's really hitting that circle edge very nicely.
And you're right, Vicky, this is their highest score so far this year. 47 in the first round, 46 in the second, and just kept to 40 goals last week to the Firebirds. So they are back in town, there's no doubt about that. Oh, contact call against. Guys, well, that is baffling.
Well, it's not the contact call, it was the replay call. Maria Dutailleur threw that, bounced past Rasmussen. And I think because it had bounced a few times, the umpire didn't really think about the fact that it was a replay. Maybe she didn't, she just called the contact call. Thought Skites had contacted before Dutailleur regathered possession. It's impressive if you're quick enough to pass the ball and then get her out of catch it.
So, an injury time. Here's a replay of the incident, Liz. Talk us through this.
There we go. She delivered it. Rasmussen didn't quite get her hands to it and picked it up again. Laura Guyte saying, hey, she threw it and she caught it. That's not in the rules.
Who would be a defender?
Masochists.
Byfield's called the injury timeout for some treatment to her right knee. So it gives Rosalie Jenke an opportunity to address her playing group, and she'd be pretty happy with what she's seen so far tonight. It is the Firebirds leading the Northern Mystics by 17 goals. Just over.
She would be happy, but she'd also be saying to a team, keep pushing through. You don't want to take your foot off the accelerator. Just doing a head-to-head goal attack. Nat Medhurst only had six more successful attempts than Maria Dutailleur, but she's been just so involved in the play. She's absolutely smashed it for centre pass receive, seven more, has been more efficient with the ball, a lot less turnovers, and the goal assists as well. So it's great to see Nat Medhurst really stringing a full game together and really dominating that part of the court. Maria Dutailleur has been effective, but not effective enough. Needs to get in there and get a bit more involved and get a bit aggressive about a play.
And Medhurst has been aggressive tonight. 28 from 33 now. As they push it down the centre corridor. Good ball into Aiken. It's a look away pass. Reaching into her bag of tricks in the final 10 minutes, perhaps. And they're destroying and dismantling in this final term, and the crowd well and truly enjoying it. A chance here to make it 20 goals the difference, and Aitken does just that. So she scored 32 goals last week, Romelda Aitken, the Jamaican superstar shooter, and 34 already tonight. So she's topped last week's result as they bring it down again.
Look, and more importantly, she's looked a lot more comfortable this week, and she's got a lot more support from Medhurst, as well as being in the play and setting her up. Medhurst has contributed 28 shots compared to last week's 8. Admittedly, she doesn't have Monia Gerard up in her face tonight. That's got to make you more comfortable as a goal attack. But it certainly gives them a good base to work off.
How far can they go, Liz, if they continue to play like this? We mentioned, you know, many touted them premiership favourites, won the pre-season comp. They finished fifth last year. For the second straight year, they missed the finals by percentage, so yet to finish in the top four. But a couple of changes and a new coach, how far do you think they can go?
Look, I think they can go all the way. They've just got to tighten up a few things, and just this combination between Aitken and Medhurst is the key to that. just being able to open up space for each other, looking for each other, Medhurst in particular, just finding her feet. The sooner they can bed that down, the better they'll be. They'll come up against Southern Steel next week in New Zealand, and then they've got a pretty tough run, Vixens and Fever, before they hit the bye. And then after the bye, they hit the Swifts and Thunderbirds. They need to win most of those games. You can't afford to drop too many matches.
Well, they came into this year with so much to prove, I guess, having suffered the heartbreak of missing the past two finals by the smallest of margins. So looking to bury their demons and fulfil their talent, and after a slow start, starting to really find their rhythm.
It's good to see Rosalie Jenke electing to leave this top seven on. They need to run it in, despite the fact that they're up by a lot. It's not the time to make changes. It's the time to let this combination settle.
That's exactly what they're doing. Aitken makes it 22 goals the difference. Sting gone out of this game, but don't forget, after the match, we've got the Mars Monday night wrap. Vixens were involved in a big game over in New Zealand earlier tonight, so we'll have all the highlights from that. They remain undefeated, so too do the Swifts as we wrap up round four. And the Mystics to come. I've got the Vixens, as we mentioned, next Monday night. You'll catch that, all the action on one, and then the Tactics, the Magic and the Steel.
Yeah, that's a tough little run as well. I guess there's no easy games in this competition, even when you look at a team like Pulse, who haven't won a game yet. The moment they're able to string together four consistent quarters, they'll start beating teams as well. And that's what you want to see in this competition.
We should turn to the record books, because they're in line to record their highest ever score, the Queensland Firebirds. In fact, they've just equaled it. So plenty of time here on track for Firebirds to record their highest ever score in the ANZ Championship. It was 66 heading into tonight, and they've equaled that. So well and truly put their foot down.
Contact, goal defense,
there you are. Let's go courtside again. Vicky Wilson.
Well, they really are doing it very easy now, Cal. But it's interesting, Firebirds make no changes, nor the Mystics have been making changes all night, and they're the ones that are really struggling. Harlu really hasn't helped the cause any down here. It's really so open for the Firebirds, and it's this funny old game. Once you find that rhythm and you're the front runners, it's really hard for a team that's chasing them to try and, you know, stem the flow.
Can they record their highest ever victory, their highest ever score in the ANZ Championship? They need one more goal. Nurse to Aitken. And there we have it. I just wonder whether they're aware of this, Liz, at all. But history tonight in Brisbane, the Queensland Firebirds recording their highest ever score. So a night to celebrate after a horror start to the season.
And to be honest, I don't think they'd care. I think they care about the 2 points. They will be absolutely wrapped with their performance tonight. It hasn't been a win where they've had to scrap and fight. They did all the hard work early, and they're able to push it home now. And I'm really pleased to see that they're actually pushing out the margin. You see, defensively, they're still really focused in attack, just making sure that they're settled with the ball.
I know you've got to give your votes, Liz, but Natalie Medhurst, 8 goals last week at 53%. Coach would have asked more of her tonight. 29 from 34, that's not bad.
Yeah, she's been particularly impressive. 19 centre pass received, she's dominated in that regard as well. A couple of rebounds, an intercept.
This team finally starting to gel. 4 minutes left in this game. The long ball comes into Latu, just starting to open up as the players tire a little. Firebirds by 21.
Contact, goal attack.
The biggest ever winning margin is by 28, so still a chance for a bit of history there as well. Why not do it all in one night?
Advantage offside wing. Contact, goalkeeper.
Maybe they want to save a little trick for later in the season.
Need to keep something up your sleeve.
That's right.
Something to aim for.
No doubt they have looked up at the scoreboard. It'd be nice to get 70. The Mystics, they would have looked at the scoreboard and think, OK, let's aim for 50. Just keep continue to set yourself goals. It's a lovely little play there between Tutaier and Latu. She's got, she's such a tall player, Tutaier. She's got really lovely soft hands.
Byfield, well done. Mystics sharing it around. Henry, it's been a tough night for her, so too George.
Look, I know Vic thinks there's not much wrong with Jolene Henry. I have to say she looks to me like she's carrying, could be just the remnants of an injury. She's normally so much more dominant than this. She'd be up in Medhurst's face and physical and aggressive, and she's not been like that at all tonight.
And Rosalie Jenke Liz, she's on the verge of her first ever win as a coach in the ANZ Championship. Obviously an Australian assistant coach, but came in this year, so she'd be pretty happy with herself as well.
Yeah, look, she's had huge shoes to fill, and I'm not saying that just because Vicky Wilson can hear what we're saying, but, you know, Rosalie has looked really nervous on the sidelines in the first couple of games, and I reckon that's transferred across to her team on occasion. You look to your coach often just to give you your anchor in terms of just the emotions that you feel on court. Rose can relax now in the knowledge that she's chalked up her first win, and it's been a great win. I spoke to her earlier in the week, and she wanted to play back then. She was ready for the game and just couldn't believe she had to wait four more days for it. So I'm really rapt for her that she's been able to achieve a win, and she can now just settle into the coaching position and really stamp her own authority on the team.
Just over a minute left. Sarah Wall in the centre position. Coughs it up on that occasion, but has been pretty good tonight. And another player that has moved on from the Melbourne Vixens. We've seen a lot of West Coast Fever, and now Sarah Wall moving up to Brisbane in the off-season and getting a lot more court time and making the most of it.
Yeah, and it's great to see when players do that. They start to flourish just when they are given the opportunity. Erin Bell's another one. Left the Swifts last year. Wasn't getting enough court time for her liking and has picked up plenty of court time in the wing attack position. She's pretty happy just to be getting on court, no matter what bib she's wearing. So sometimes for a young player, you do need to move and take the opportunities where they arise.
Well, less than a minute. Why not try it all? It comes off for Latu. Got it back down to 17. It was well over 20 at one point earlier in this quarter. So the Mystics have remained brave. 8-2 dominant though. That's her 41st goal for the evening from 51 attempts. As we count down to full time to wrap up round four, and the crowd really enjoying it now. Firebirds record their highest ever score in the ANZ Championship. More importantly, their first win of the year. They're on the board officially. It's the Firebirds with a 17-goal win over the Northern Mystics to wrap up round four in the ANZ Championship.
A really important win for the Firebirds. They'll gain confidence from this, not only from the fact that they won, but by the fact that they won so well. They pushed through the entire 60 minutes, every player standing up to be counted. Romelda Aiken, 41 goals from 52 attempts. That's huge. But they'll also look to Nat Medhurst and say, well done you, 30 goals from 35 attempts. When you look at the stats sheet, every single player has contributed. It's been a full team effort, really impressive stuff from them. And this young team will enjoy this moment, their first win of 2010.
They certainly will, as the Northern Mystics look at the scoreboard and think of what might have been. There's nothing in it in the opening half, but then the Firebirds really put their foot down in that third term and blew the Mystics away. And the coach, Rosalie Jenke, really enjoying it. Mystics face a long flight home to Auckland, back in Melbourne next week. So it's the top double. Let's get down to Vicky Wilson. She's got the star of the show tonight, Natalie Medhurst.
Well, Nat, it's taken four games, but you finally got the first win on the board. It must be a huge relief.
Yeah, it feels bloody great to finally get a win. It's, yeah, the first 3 weeks have been disappointing. So to get a win on the boards, yeah, fantastic.
So what did you focus on coming into this game?
I think just playing our game and focusing on what we do well. I think we probably overanalyzed the first few games, and we just went out there and do what we do best, and I think we had fun out there, which certainly helped.
On a personal note, didn't have your best game last week, but tonight you really stepped up to the plate and delivered. Your work rate out in front was fantastic.
Thank you. Yeah, I was a disgrace last week, so to be honest, so it was nice. I don't like playing too many bad games, so it was good to, I guess, play a bit better and, yeah, come away with the win.
Now, next week you've got to go down to Invercargill, and it's a really tough trip. No Australian team has ever won there. Can you turn it around?
Most definitely. I think if we can put out what we did tonight, and we know it's going to be tough, and, you know, I think now we've got the ball rolling, and I think the attitude around the team's going to be a lot better now, which, it'll be hopefully help us for next week.
Thanks, Nat. Congratulations.
Well, Natalie Medhurst, brutally honest and a sign of a champion as well.
I was just thinking, you don't want to be too scathing of players in commentary. We don't need to worry about that. She's worse on herself than we could ever be.
Well, 8 from 15 last week and then 30 from 35 tonight. So she hit back in style. 17 test caps to her name as well, and you'd think she'll be there in India come October for the Commonwealth Games. She is a real star of the game.
Well, it is a battle for that second goal attack position. You'd have to assume Sherelle McMahon, as the captain of the team, has that sewn up. But the next goal attack position is being keenly fought for. Nat Medhurst tonight has well and truly put a hand up for that spot. But more importantly, she's put her team on the map.
Well, don't go away. The drought is officially over for the Queensland Firebirds. Right after this, we've got the Mars Monday Night Wrap. All the details from round 4. It's the Firebirds celebrating a breakthrough win, their first for season 2010. They did it in style.
And so, unfortunately, the Northern Mystics at the hands of the Queensland Firebirds, they are celebrating their first win of the 2010 ANZ Championships with a 71-54 victory over the Mystics. Pretty impressive game, particularly from Nat Medhurst. She was outstanding tonight for the Firebirds.
Yeah, and if we have a look at the final score, Liz, it was their highest ever score in the ANZ Championship to date. So what's that, nearly 2.5 years? Previous high score was 66, so they've beaten that well and truly. And their new coach would be pretty thrilled with this. As we have a look at their match stats, what do they tell us in the end?
Well, after a scrappy start, both teams really cleaned up on their turnover rates. Firebirds in particular sitting at 12 for the game. That's impressive given what was at stake today. Still lots of whistle going on in the game. Both teams giving over well and truly over 50 penalties each. So I'll go back and address that and figure out how they can keep the umpires out of the game next week.
And another impressive statistic was for the Firebirds was that they extended their lead at every break. And you spoke about that in the last quarter as a team that's, you know, on the verge of your first win for the year. You want to make sure that you do put your foot down. They led by 3 at the first, 5 at halftime, 14, and in the end, 17.
Yeah, and it was great to see. They had, like all good teams, had a great third quarter, winning that quarter 20 points to 11. So not only did they put the accelerator down for their scoring rate, their defensive rate also picked up, and they were able to hold the Mystics to only 11 goals. Now that's impressive given the Mystics' firepower in Latu and Tutair. So well done the Firebirds. Every game they've played so far, they've won 2 quarters. Today they won 4.
What is it about New Zealand teams trying to win on Australian soil? Only one team's been able to do it before. It wasn't the Mystics night tonight, but they'll certainly be a contender this year, no doubt about that. It's vote time. I don't think you even need to be a netball expert to work out who got best on court tonight.
Well,
No surprise.
We've been waiting for Nat Medhurst to have a game like this, and she's done it, picking up 3 votes with 30 goals. She was instrumental in setting up Romelda Aitken's 41 goals as well. Claire McMenamin is the unsung hero of this team. She just worked so hard off the ball in wing defence, and Laura Guyte's picking up a vote just for her intercepts tonight.
Well, there it is, the Holden Crews, the best small car going around. At the end of the year, one of these lucky netballers will get the keys to this, and perhaps it just might be Natalie Medhurst. It was the Adelaide Thunderbirds captain, Natalie Von Berto, who took it out last year, as there we see Medhurst fighting back from a horror week last week. It was a really tough night for her. She said it herself. She was a disgrace, and she wins $1,000 for the Millicent Netball Club in South Australia. So no doubt they'll be watching, and they'll be pretty happy with that.
They will. That's a South Australian junior, but playing for Queensland now. We'll take a look at the Player of the Year votes. Renee Hallinan picked up 2 votes tonight in the game across the Tasman, and Sheryl McMahon picked up 3, so that rockets them to the top of the table. No surprises that the Swifts are up there as well. They are the only other undefeated team with the Vixens.
And we have a look at the Team of the Year. Just another interesting little stat we like to throw your way, and no surprises, as you said, Liz. The Vixens and the Swifts undefeated, and, well, it makes sense. We've talked about how good your maths is tonight, that they lead the way. They're sharing it as well.
Us netballers, we're a friendly lot. Although there'll be no love lost when those two meet each other in a couple of rounds' time. That will be a great game to look forward to.
We very much look forward to that. For now, well, in the end, it was the Firebirds. They were in total control in their round 4 clash here in front of their home side in Brisbane tonight. And stick around, because we will wrap up round 4 in the ANZ Championship right after this. It's the Mars Monday Night Wrap coming your way. The Firebirds, too good in the end, 17 goal victors over the Mystics. Welcome back to the Mars Monday Night Wrap, where, Liz, we look at the weekend that was, and it was all the Aussies playing all the Kiwis team in round 4 rivalry round, and we kick it off with the Magic hosting the Fever. And the Magic took the points in the end. They got over the line by 5 goals.
They did, but Fever were ahead at half-time by just a single goal. It was just some outstanding defensive work from Casey Williams. It set up a lot of play and started to feed the ball down to their front line. Magic only won 1 quarter, which was no surprise. It's a championship quarter, the 3rd quarter, but they did so decisively. They set up win with an 18-11 third period.
And Irene van Dijk, we see her on screen there. She's like a good wine. She gets better with age, doesn't she? But 41 from 42, shooting at 98%. That's 1 miss. And I'm guessing we're not going to see it in these highlights here for the entire game.
No, and she's got this really good combination going with Jodie Brown. Brown's just a really clever player. Doesn't look particularly fast, but he's really smart with the body, smart with the placement and of her body, and also smart with the placement of the ball. So Irene van Dijk benefiting from that experience sitting out the front of her as well.
And the Magic now, what does it mean for them? We know they lost the first game of the year to the Vixens, and perhaps some questions were raised. 3 in a row they've hit back with, and they are genuine contenders.
They are. They lost that first game really on the back of some really, I guess, unusual coaching decisions. But now having Jodie Brown out the front of Irene van Dijk, they're starting to look good. So one little thing that is a little bit troublesome for them, they had 26 turnovers in that match, and that's still a lot. You don't want to be coughing up the ball that often.
Well, it was the Magic by 5. The Swifts played their first home game against the Pulse, their first home game of the year, and they came in undefeated, and it was probably a little closer than many expected in the end.
Well, the Pulse led by as much as 5 before half-time, and we're looking pretty good. And I keep saying that they are a team that will start to win games. They're good, but so far across a lot of their games, they've only been good for a half. And again, just some interesting coaching decisions made. The defensive line of Grant and Abwaze got changed at half-time, and that, to me, really opened up Prattley and allowed her to come into the game more and allowed the Swiss front line to dominate.
Well, it was 10 in a row at the start of the 3rd quarter that really turned the game on its head, and great to see Kath Cox coming back and finding some form. The final score was 50-36. So what have you made of Kath Cox? Started a little slow, but got there in the end on the weekend.
Yeah, she did, but also some impressive defensive work. Pulse only scored 11 goals in the second half.
Well, that's it. We're halfway through round 4. We'll have a look at the final 2 games of rivalry round right after this. You're watching the Mars Monday Night Wrap. And welcome back to the Mars Monday Night Wrap. It is rivalry round in the ANZ Championship, round number 4, and the Thunderbirds made it 2 in a row, Liz, with a big win over the Steel.
Yeah, they did. A one-point win over Firebirds the week before. They did it tough in this game, though. They're only 1 goal ahead of Steel at half-time. Steel really beautifully led around the court by captain Megan Dean. She did an absolute wealth of work. Monia Gerard came into the match did a great job, started to shut down Dean in the second half. And Jeeva Mentor picked up some really impressive intercepts for them as well. And they were able to set up the win in the third quarter.
Yeah, and a big last quarter from them as well. The Thunderbirds, well, they dropped their first two and eyebrows were raised, but two in a row, back-to-back wins, and they're starting to gel.
And if you had asked me before last week's game against the Firebirds, even after last week's game, I don't think they won that convincingly, whether they'd be in the mix come finals time. I wouldn't have been certain. The second half that they played yesterday is the best half that I've seen from any team in this competition this year. They really sent out a warning to the rest of the competition. But they are here. They are going to be contenders again this year.
And what sets it up for them is the two down back. They are fierce. They're physical. Mentor and Gerard starting to find their feet and their elbows and their bodies and everything else, I think.
And everyone else's bodies. But Shani Layton got brought on at wing defence for her debut match for the Thunderbirds. And I reckon she did a good job in that position as well.
Well, there you have it. The final score. Did it easy in the end. The Thunderbirds put their foot down in that last quarter. 53-36. Borrego, she is the superstar Jamaican. 37 from 45.
Yeah, and Kate Beveridge chipping in as well. She had a wealth of work out the front of Borrego and was really good in the first half, I thought. She came up with the Vivian Bullwinkle Anzac medal as well.
Well, earlier tonight, the Vixens won on the road against the Tactics in Christchurch, but no surprises with the result. The surprise was that they were missing three of their starting seven. No Julie Corletto, no Nash and no Chocolate. So that is a big result for them.
It's a huge result for them. The other thing that's really pleasing for them is that Wendy Jones, to see her there with the ball, started a little bit slowly but started to look really comfortable as this game progressed and did a really good job. Demelza McLeod got brought into the team again to cover Julie Corletto and played well as well. There was a fair bit of bump and barge in the match, but you'd expect that, wouldn't you?
Yeah, Renee Hellinan with a bit of an elbow just to go through those injuries. Corletto out with, well, they said she was rested, obviously had knee surgery over summer. Nash did her ankle at training during the week. And Chocolate, we saw her maybe just pull a calf muscle or do something to a calf muscle last week. She did make the trip but didn't get any court time.
That's a big win for them to have so many players out injured and to go across the Tasman and beat Tactics, who would have been feeling pretty good after taking the Swifts into extra time last week. It's a hugely important win for the Vixens over there. Ali Broadbent gave the points. Cheryl McMahon picked up three votes. Renee Howland and two, and Caitlin Thwaite one. Caitlin Thwaite's one, and I reckon, have a look at the shooting stats and that explains the votes.
There you have it. The Vixens, 64 to the Tactics, 49. What are you saying there, Liz? Thwaites with 39. Put a couple of good weeks together, Caitlin Thwaites.
Yeah, she certainly has. And also good to note that Brooke Thompson got a full game for the Vixens as well. So it's great for her to get some court time under her belt.
All right, let's have a look at a couple of the leaderboards after round four. And we start with the goal shooters because they're the glamour side of this game. Netball, Irene van Dyke, we spoke about in the last break, her wonderful week and missing just the one goal. So she moves into top spot for goal shooter of the year.
Yeah, this is on shooting percentage. The shooters have to shoot over 100 goals to be eligible. Irene van Dyke's well and truly past that milestone.
Intercepts, we saw her in action tonight. Byfield for the Mystics. She is athletic and she leads with 11.
She certainly is, and she added to that total again tonight. And rebounder of the year, Laura Geitz, picked up a number of those. She's taken a strong lead, and her and Romelda Aitken will be fighting each other for that prize at the end of the year.
Well, let's move to the all-important championship ladder after four rounds. Of course, there's 14 before the finals kick off in this league. And the Vixens and the Swifts, the two dominant Aussie sides, remain undefeated at the top of the ladder, anchored at the bottom. You've got to feel sorry for them a little bit. The Central Pulse, winless after four rounds. Only one win from 2 years for them.
Yeah, and the Firebirds just creeping up the ladder. But have a look at their percentage. Should they string a couple more games together and need percentages to get into the top four, they have done themselves an incredible favour tonight by really pushing out that margin.
And one New Zealand team in the top four.
Yeah, but two just out of it. They need to lift their goal ratings, but there'll be a couple of Kiwi teams who'll fight for that one of those positions in the top four towards the end of the year.
And, of course, we'll kick it off all next week. It is round five that will start. We'll be back next Monday night with the Mars Monday Night Wrap. Tonight, it was the Queensland Firebirds celebrating their first win of the year over the Northern Mystics.